also annotate it with words so that you understand what the key point is. So the key here is to do it both visually and verbally. So that just as in all things, we're constantly asking you to show and explain. We need the visual evidence, and then the words, whatever words you can add to support and help and make sure we get the point, right? And this is in keeping with what state rules? Remember the state? Missouri is the state. And why is Missouri the important state that we care about? It's the Shoney state, exactly. Remember, Missouri is the Shoney state? And so, playing by Missouri rules, you never say anything that you're not showing, right? These are words to live by in architecture school. You should not be talking about anything that you're not presenting, you're not showing us the visual evidence. So this is all about the visual evidence first, and then as a vehicle for ideas. And sometimes we don't always pick up directly what you mean when you're showing it to us, so you help us out with the words. It's the visual first, the verbal second. If you want to say something, you got to show it. Speaking of which, how do we succeed on these sketch assignments? Because Tuesday is not only exam day, it's also sketch assignment is due day. Some of you have been asking me, hey, there's still a zero on Blackboard for my sketch assignments. What up with that? When are you going to grade my sketch assignments? And I said, oh, I thought I've already graded all of them. I'm sorry, I'll take a look. Well, I took a look. And guess what? I can't access the grading rubric until something gets uploaded to Blackboard. So if you have a zero in Blackboard, please upload a single PDF with your sketches from last time. If I were you, I would want the feedback from the last sketch assignment before I commit to submitting something for the second sketch assignment, because I don't want to be making the same mistakes on the second one that I made on the first one. Who's with me? Right? I hate making the same mistake that I made before. Please give me feedback so I don't make that mistake again. I will give you feedback, but in order to access my feedback machine, I need you to submit a PDF with your sketches. Does that make sense? There's like 8 people with zeros. You shouldn't have zeros. You did the work. I know you did the work. But I need the PDF in Blackboard to give you the feedback. So, okay, any questions on that? In the meantime, you know, because you saw it in the assignment, that there are 3 key characteristics that we're looking for in the sketches. There's 3 rubric categories. One of them is, did you submit a physical copy, PDF on Blackboard, and JPEGs on Nuclear? Did you use the right file name? You just following directions. Did you do it the right format? Please don't submit 3 different PDFs with probably new names. Submit 1 PDF that says Sketches 2, your last name. And so that's one of them. That's the easy one. It's just reading and following the directions. The more important one, the hardest one to get 5 out of 5 points on, is the graphic quality. So if you invest time and effort and produce something of sufficient quality such that it can convey ideas, then you're going to be scoring 5 out of 5. here's another way to get less than five. Do a lot of work and spend a lot of time on it. Well, let me state it this way. Here's a way to spend less time and get a higher score. Who likes to do that? Right? So here's how you do it. Don't tell me. It's not cheating if you trace. It's not cheating if you project onto the piece of paper and you sketch. And here's why that's not cheating. We don't care if you have a God-given gift. Well, we do care. It's great if you have a gift from God to very quickly and accurately produce a sketch without visual assistance. But we should be up beyond that. We are architects. We have tools. We have techniques. One of the most powerful of our superpowers as architects is the superpower of tracing. That is a secret weapon. And you can get very accurate. How did you do this, Adam? How did you do this? Did you trace? Did you trace? So you did the outline by chasing, you put it on, but it's on opaque paper, right? It's not on the vellum or chaser. A light table. Who's got a light table? Who's got a window? Okay, if you have a window in your life, and if you are ever awake during the daylight hours, this paper, you print it out, you tape it, okay? You can also project. So Madeline's hint is to trace the rough outline, but then do the rest. You don't have to trace it. Okay? Questions on how to draw this? So here's the other thing. The third and final five-point thing has to do with the idea and the analysis. Like, are you capturing the big idea of the project? You might be writing an awful lot saying, I don't know, Columbus, what did I say, Columbus? You could say Jefferson was the author of the Declaration of Independence. You could write that on. You could say Jefferson proposed the land ordinance of 1784 that established the universal grid for most of the 48 states. You could write that. But those things are just text that have nothing to do with the visual evidence. And so that's not a good strategy. I'm assuming that you want to get the most impact, the least amount of effort and time, and the least amount of distraction. If you want to do that, draw these drawings in a way that they relate to each other in order to better access directly the ideas of Monticello. Draw it in a way that starts to get at the heart of what is important about this work and or important to you about this work. That's the first step. Draw in a way that gets at the big ideas. The second step is write about those big ideas. Say things like the symmetry of the plan presents a very formal sense of order and authority. But don't just say that. Draw a center line right down the middle and point at that and say, axial symmetry presents a very strong formal order in the name of establishing the status of the new young nation state of the United States. Right? You can do the same thing on the front facade. The classical orders, you can point to the classical orders, the pediment, references to Greece and Rome, exude authority of the young nation state. You could also put a line and say symmetry. The dome. The It's an octagonal dome, not quite like the Pantheon, but still exuding the authority. And so you can get to that. You can talk about the staircase, as she does, going down to the slave quarters. Now, what's the big idea? Who cares about the stairs and the slave quarters? Is it because we love sex rumors? This is the Stormy Daniels scandal of the early United States. Like, who cares? Well, here's why we care. Slavery turned out to be one of the defining issues of who we are as a nation and a society. So it matters that the most articulate champion of enlightenment, human rights and values, is also a slave owner. So that matters. Does that make sense? So read and follow the directions in terms of submission. Draw it quickly, but with care and precision and in a way that gets at the big ideas. And then once you've shown us the big ideas, follow up by telling us the big ideas. And the big ideas, start with the big ideas like authority of the young nation state, slaves, and then give us the details of the evidence that fleshes it out and makes it convincing and helps us verify these are not just empty words. These are the visual evidence is there, but here's the detail of it. Right? Any questions about how to get 15 out of 15 on the sketch assignments? Every one of you should see a point increase on the second wave. Okay? No questions? Which brings us to the exam questions. Same deal. Right? I can say the words exam questions, and I can point to this, because you're not going to be doing a lot of sketching very carefully. You're not going to be tracing, you're not going to be doing really beautiful drawings. But the part that overlaps between the sketch assignment and the exam questions has to do with Missouri rules. Show us and tell us about it. Okay, let's look at an example of that. So how did she get 2 out of 2 points on every single one of these questions? Well, the first thing you notice before you even read it is there's always a visual component. When it says show and sketch and explain, she's sketching and then explaining. She's not directly referring to the sketch in the first one, but I immediately know she knows what she's talking about. She's doing exactly the right step. She's not saying the words universal grid, which is the secret password when it comes to Durand. He was proposing a universal grid for all projects. But I see that she is talking about this idea of universal grid immediately. Even before I read the text in which she refers to the fact that the taller masonry structure gets, the thicker the structure needs to be the base, even before I read that in the words, I see that she's sketching exactly the right things on top of those images. And so she's showing it and she's talking about it. She could have chosen the German, but she chose the English. She's drawing Westminster Abbey. I recognize it. And just in case it's not clear in the sketch, she says it, Westminster, a fugitive. Fugitive and buried, close enough. And she's saying, I know about this mathematically clear structure. That is not essential to the core of the question, but she's using this as an excuse to demonstrate her mastery. Right. Here, she gets right to the heart of the matter. The Gothic Revival hotel front, it barely touches that and it conceals it, whereas here, it's expressed. So this is the kind of quiz exam response strategy that works. Any questions for me or Ms. Simmons? It's all clear? Which brings us to the next one. Exam question. Here's an example of an exam question. Identify at least two examples, and whenever we say that, we're interested in the year of conception or the year span. It's up to you. I'm good with just the year of conception. What's the name of the work? And where is it? What's the place name? And I've already told you this is by Frank Lloyd Wright, but when we don't say that, then if you can say the name of the creator of the work, that's good too. Have you noticed that when you get 3 out of 4, you don't lose any points? Often you get 2 out of 4, we're good. But to really give us the confidence that you own this material, you can please see if you can give us all 4 of those key things that are key to the identity. So again, you are identifying 2 examples, and it might be 2 examples from a single work, to show and explain the Prairie School principle of architecture that emerges from the site. Architecture that emerges from the site. So it might be useful to draw a quick little sketch. So it might be easier to draw a quick little sketch when the exam time comes if you draw a quick little sketch during class, during the lecture. And so hopefully your notes are highly sketchified. Your notes should be like your sketchbook more generally, filled with words and pictures, or if we're following Missouri rules, filled with pictures and words. Here's another example of a quiz question. Show and explain at least 2 key points about Wright's 1938 Jacob's House left and his 1934 Broadacre City project right. Now there were some problems printing out the exam last time. I was trying to soften the grays so that you could draw on top of the pictures with clarity. But that messed up the image. I apologize for that. This time when we're going to do this, we're going to leave it at full 100% not grayed out. So you might want to bring a pen, or you might want to be a little bolder with your pencil work when you're drawing on top of these images. Remember, that's how this worked so well, because it was so clear what was being drawn on top of those images. So be prepared for some images that might need you to be a little bolder if you're going to be drawing on top of it. Okay. So you'll notice that the in-class assignment looks an awful lot like this. The lecture itself is structured to facilitate this kind of grasp of the material. We're going to be looking at the work of Frank Lloyd Wright. This is one of the rare cases where a single architect is dominating the entire lecture. And all of the work is the name of this game is what's happening, what is the architecture doing, how is the architecture doing it, how would you show that, how would you explain that? Okay? Everybody ready to start our show, start the game? So that in-class assignment in front of you is your scorecard. And because this might be useful for studying for the exam on Tuesday, how about if I collect them, I scan them through the machine that goes jump, 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 jump. And if you want to pick up your in-class exercise sheet, I'll leave them on the countertop in the office. Does that sound like a good idea? That way you can invest some work on these in-class exercises and benefit from it already as you prepare for Tuesday's exam. Okay. So, Frank Lloyd Wright. What's important about Frank Lloyd Wright? What should we know? Well, he was not just inspired by the arts and crafts movement, remember that? The Red House, William Morris, the wallpaper. He was also an inspiration for the arts and crafts movement, especially his early work, where he's very invested in the material qualities and the richness of materials and allowing those materials to express themselves architecturally. He also worked for Louis Sullivan. Remember Louis Sullivan? He did a lot of the work in the Chicago World Columbian Exposition in 1893. And he is probably most well known, he has the biggest impact for this short period of his life when he first started his first his career on his own after leaving Avon and Sullivan. He created a series of houses, which is known as the Prairie School period, and it's primarily houses for wealthy clients in the Chicago area. But he also did a few other things during the same time period, including the Unity Temple, which we'll be looking at. And one of the most interesting things about this topic, Frank Lloyd Wright, and something that will continue throughout the rest of the course, is he had a profound impact on what was happening in Europe in the next few decades. And so that's, in a way, for the rest of this course and for the rest of your careers, it is useful to understand that even though there was kind of this hate, this competition, this really disdain for each other, the European modernists and Frank Lloyd Wright, they didn't really like each other. At the same time, European modernism is, to a large extent, the offshoots of the ideas and the early experimentation of Frank Lloyd Wright, especially during the Prairie School years that were presented in the Wassmuth portfolio. And it wasn't just the Wassmuth portfolio, there were many publications that were going to address. Okay. And then there's the Broadacre City Musonian work that comes later. So let's start with the Prairie School period. So he worked for Adler and Sullivan, the architects of the Auditorium building in Chicago, among other things, from 1888 to 1893. In 1893, he gets his own commission, and he steps out on his own, and he starts to build these homes for wealthy clients in and around Chicago. So this was the first one, the Winslow House, and there is symmetry. So some of the characteristics of the Prairie School are asymmetrical, kind of like the Red House. There might be moments of symmetry, but it was largely thrown off. But just look at this before we codify all the characteristics of it. Just take it in and see if you can understand some of the things going on here. There's a very strong division of base, shaft, and capital. And it's almost classical in that three-part division. It's not at all classical, right? But there's a three-part division that gives it a sense of beginning, middle, and end that is sympathetic to the classical attitude. And then there's this new thing called a garage. Because what's happening at this time is we get the invention of the automobile, and very, very wealthy people are getting automobiles, but they're still extremely expensive, so it's a status thing, it's no longer, it's not yet a necessity of all life. You don't go out naked and you don't go out without a car. That's the American way. It's in that order. So Moore Winslow House, there's a very strong artistic aspect to the way he uses wood. And he builds these very strong cabinet-like built-in furniture into the house. So there's a similarity to what we've seen in the Arts and Crafts movement. And this very, and again, Arts and Crafts aspect of these art windows, this stained glass window, which is something that we see throughout the work of Frank Lloyd Wright. The windows are a great opportunity for artistic expression. And so here's some general characteristics of the Prairie School houses. But instead of going with this list, which is something we create after the fact, I've decided to de-emphasize this list. It's just there for your entertainment values. These are all things that you might enjoy. But it's interesting to look at Frank Lloyd Wright's own house and some of the other houses, but in terms that he, 20 years after he stopped this period, 20 years after this period ended, he looks back on it and he says, there are 9 things. And so we're going to use his 9 things, although they do incorporate all of the other things we talked about. So he has a number of houses in this period. He actually builds over 100 houses in the course of these 17 years. That's a lot of work. He's very busy. The plans, they're all variations on the same set of themes that he is taking. It's almost like he did his sophomore year project, and then he does it again, and then he does it again, and he's trying to get it better each time with a new client. And this is the thing that Frank Lloyd Wright is known for better or worse, is you have less of a sense that you are hiring him than when you interview him for the job. It's almost like you are the one being interviewed as the client. And if he accepted you as a client, you had to do things his way because he had the next phase of his experiment. So he has these very strong orthogonal axes, always a major axis and a minor axis. And then locally, so here's, I should be pointing whenever I say words like that, a major axis, a minor axis. And then it's repeated locally. Here's a local major axis and a local minor axis. A local major axis, local minor axis. And so you can draw center lines for rooms. You can do an analytical exercise on this floor plan, identifying all the lines of symmetry. There are multiple lines of symmetry, large and small, and so this is in a way a complex composition of multiple axial symmetries. So it's, and every complication an asymmetry is speaking to the specific role, function, and operation of each space so that the Arbeitszimmer, which means the workroom, it's all in German because this plan was drawn for the Wasmuth portfolio in German. So we have to translate to learn a little German this time. The Wohnzimmer, which is the living room, etc. And so the importance of certain things are presented in terms of their size and relationship to the whole. And then there are fireplaces, which we'll get into as a very important element. So there's an openness of space. Here's a very important fireplace. It almost looks like one of Louis Sullivan's doorway entries. But very rich built-in furniture. Furniture designed by Frank Lloyd Wright himself. In a way, it's, what was that German word? I don't remember what it was. The Zuntag, no! What was it? I know it ended with So I could show you these houses all day long. We don't have time. But here's some more. Again, a very strong base, middle, top. Always with these deep overhanging eaves, these strong overhangs. Hip roofs and very low pitch hip roofs. One of the reasons these are called prairie school houses is because it is the prairie, and the prairie is dominated by the horizon line. And the houses are designed to emphasize very strong horizontals. So you almost have this very strong horizontal plane, the domination of long horizontal planes. And you see these very interesting ends to the to some of the rooms that we're going to be looking at. Again, you see major and minor axes. Sometimes they cross. But where they cross, the most important ones cross at the fireplace, at the hearth, at the middle of the building. And there's that triangular end space at the end of the dining room. Okay, enough of this. Let's get down to it. Well, the Dana House is interesting in part because Frank Lloyd Wright, again, not to be all rumor-mongering and salacious, but he has an affair with the wife of the client here. And it causes an end to his, why does it end so abruptly in 1910? It's because he has to flee the country and all kinds of things. So he had this glorious career, and then derails, partly because his personal life gets in the way of his professional life. And there's a long period where I've heard some people refer to it as the lost years. We should be so lucky as to have those kinds of lost years. He was very productive even during his lost years. So beautiful, beautiful artwork built into the house. This is something he invented. This table and chair fold into this unit, so it's this very clever modern thing. Zonkensberg galore, he designed all of this stuff, the windows, the lamp, the furniture, the desk, just like that guy, what was his name? Henry von der yes. Let's get to the main event, because there's a house here that all the other houses were in white text. That means we're not going to ask you to know those houses. But if you do, if you want to give an example, they're all there in the slides in the PDF. You could say, Robbie House, that's Robbie House. That's a rookie building. The guy who loved the Martin House. So you can take your favorite one and make all the points that we're going to make here with the Building House, you could make those same points when the moment comes in your sketches and in the exam. You could go to the Martin House, or the Willits House, or the Dana House, or any of the houses that come before the Building House in the Prairie School House period. So here we are, the Roby House. The client is 27 years old. And he's extremely wealthy, inheriting he's a bicycle manufacturer, and he needs a fancy house on the south side of Chicago. So he commissions Frank Lloyd Wright. And it just so happens that Wright is finally figuring out how to bring it all together. So we think this is the best house that Wright does. So we are going to use, I often teach the top 20 reasons we love Frank Lloyd Wright's Prairie House style. Okay? And that's my usual way of presenting the Roby House. Top 20 reasons, we count down from 20 down to 1. But that's me. I'd rather use Frank Lloyd Wright's 9 principles when he is retrospectively looking back at his work 20 years after the fact. What does he think are his greatest breakthroughs? And he words it in a very specific way. And the full text of that let's go through them. Principle number one is the open plan. So previously, in all the traditions we've studied up until now, we have a living room, and that'd be one box. And then we go through a door, and we go to the dining room, and that'd be another box. And then we go through the door, that'd be the kitchen, that's another box. And then there'd be the parlor. And that's usually the four boxes of the ground floor of a proper home in the 19th century. And there are still separate boxes here, but this at the time was a radical thing. In a way, this is a single space with this fireplace stair element in the middle of it that's acting as a room separator. Do you see it? This is what it looks like in plan, and this is what it looks like when you experience it. Where is this photograph taken? Can you see it? Point to it. As soon as you can see where it's taken from, point to it. Do you agree? Do you want to go along with that? Is he right? Yeah. That's it. That's where it's taken from. Looking down this way. So you see these windows. So if you look on the, if I could put my hand over the projector lens, I would cover half the image and say, you just look at this half of the image and you say, is this one room or two rooms? And you say it's one room. One wall, but then I'd cover that side of the lens, and then point to this side. Says, is this one room or two rooms? You say, oh, two rooms. Right? So this is the open plan idea. Got it? Okay. Principle number two. You'll recognize this from the sample exam question. The building emerges from the site as if it's a rock. And so we're looking at the way it's expressed in the ground. It's just part of, it kind of grows out of the ground and it's connected to the site. The other thing we can tell is there are plantings around the building and there are plantings that appear within the building. There's the wall of the building, and that wall of the building becomes a landscape wall. Right? Who does that? Your parents didn't do that, right? You have your house, and then later, after they move in, you build a wall, and it's New England, so you build a stone wall, or you put in a fence. And you choose a fence out of a catalog, and no one says, well, what's your house look like? You want to match the house. No, we don't do that. But Frank Lloyd Wright said, no. The wall of the house is the wall of the garden. Not shown here. It's shown on the bottom. This is just like the work of H.H. Richardson. Remember him? He's the architect of Trinity Church. He was one of the first original American architects. He created the Richardsonian style, credited with being one of the first truly original, unique American architectural styles. And his thing was, the architecture grows out of the ground. It's an extension of the earth itself. And in a way, it's what you guys do in software studio, right? You always deal with site, complex site. What's your site this week? But last semester, you did just now. But the architecture is part of the landscape, and the design of the architecture does not end at the same location where the air conditioning ends. Right? The architecture goes beyond. The architecture leaves the building. Where's number three? Okay, that should be number three. Number three, exploding the box. On my top 20 list of the top 20 reasons, I would count down from 20 down to 1. And I would say the number one reason to love Frank Lloyd Wright's Prairie School house architecture is exploding the box. He didn't use these words. These are words that have been used since. But remember, we're talking about the box that is the living room, the box that is the dining room, the box that is the kitchen, all fitting within the box that is the house. All houses, all buildings, basically just boxes, right? Now, when Frank Lloyd Wright has anything to do with it, he blows those boxes apart. He blows walls out. And these are floating planes that hover in proximity and cross. It's all part of this major and minor axial crossings. It becomes a dynamic composition of floating planes. The space of the building is defined not by six planes and eight corners. He almost takes away, he softens or eliminates two or three of those six planes. And he softens or obliterates a couple of those corners. So it still functions to contain and enclose and protect. But the sense of the box is softened and becomes the space that is defined generally and loosely by these hovering planes. So look for, this is in a way the most important characteristic of this lecture. And so this is something to struggle and look for. It has become something that has been the struggle for the entire 20th century and continues to be an issue. How do you compose architectural space as a composition of interpenetrating volumes defined by overlapping and loosely associated planes? The words don't work. I can only say that because I'm showing you something. And even then, it's so hard to explain. So number four, the real number four, is the raised platform. So we don't like boxes for our architecture, and we certainly don't like coffins buried in the ground. Who wants to live in a box that's buried underground? You do? Very good question. So, okay, to each his own. But Frank Lloyd Wright said, hey, let's lift that basement out of the ground at least enough to get some light in there. And so the half-buried basement to let some light into the windows, that's a good thing. At the same time, again, remember that classical resonance, that sympathy with the classical base, shaft, capital, bottom, middle, top, is giving us a strong platform, is giving us a strong platform upon which to stack up the rest of the building. And so the main floor of the house is lifted up, which gives privacy. The clients, the roadies, they really wanted to be able to look out their windows. They wanted a lot of windows, and they wanted to be able to look out and see what was going on without necessarily being seen. They like privacy. They kind of want the panopticon benefits of being able to look out and see the world without necessarily exposing themselves to the world and being seen. So this was one way to do it. Number five, this was one of his secret weapons for softening and for exploding the box. He would take what would normally be the exterior wall that would have some punched windows. And instead of having punched windows, he would remove that wall entirely. And then in a very Japanese-like manner, he would fill that gap with a screen of glass. You would make it as light as possible. Well, how light can you make it in 1908? About this letter. So he's de-emphasizing, he's pushing us to read this as a wall of glass with a few dividers along the way as part of this continuous stream. He was trying to get us to read this as a single thing. And he gets more sophisticated about that later. Look for this, if I don't mention it, point it out to me when we get to Trinity, not Trinity, Unity Temple. No punched windows. Punched windows was a crime similar to creating boxes. Compositional clarity, single materials for each distinct form element. And so because he was creating these flowing planes, he would say, hey everybody, here's an element. In case you're not clear, I'm going to make it a single material, a single color. I'm going to express it as much as I can as a single element. This includes creating one of our favorite tricks in contemporary architecture, which is to whatever the, what do you call that? It's not a fascia, it's a soffit. Whatever the material is of the overhang, make it coplanar with the material of the ceiling on the interior. So just to make that, just so we're clear, this is an element and it's one thing. You build a house and then you bring in a big crane, this huge roof, and you just stick it in there. That's what you want us to think, even if you never do that, even if that's impossible. He wants to read it as a singular element that was prefabricated and dropped into place. And then do that everywhere. And make that distinct from whatever vertical elements you have. Look at this chimney. My goodness, look at that chimney. That chimney is going to be the dominant vertical element that pierces every single one of these prairie school houses. And there it is, in the drawing I made when I was an undergraduate, looking at the vertical elements and isolating them. So here are the thin elements that define the screens on the basement and main living level. And then the chimney elements and how that is clearly identifiable as a singular vertical element. And I'm using the word here of stereotonic. It's a stereotonic mass. Who uses words like stereotonic? And what's the opposite of stereotonic? It's in the first lecture of the course this semester. Who's that German guy? All those German guys that maybe start with S. Schinkel's good guess. Wasn't Schinkel the other guy? Semper, that's it. So the German theorist Gottfried Semper, he said, hey, there are four elements of architecture. There's the hearth, which is a stereotonic, a solid thing that's massive when you cut into it. It's like an extension of the earth. So you have the hearth is element number one, the roof is element number two. That's supposed to be a roof. And the roof is not stereotonic. It is stick built. It is framed. It has elements, linear elements. So that's tectonic. And then there's the enclosure, which Semper said, hey, this is weaving. Remember the weaving thing? So that's tectonic. And then the mound, we talked about the mound. So the thing that's important here, when I revise these slides before next year, I'm going to say these four things are not that important. The most important thing is the distinction between stereotonic and tectonic. These are the things that matter. These are the things that we still refer to the tectonic in studio. Who Let's start there and start to say the word technology.
Yeah, let's start that.
Who's heard there and start to say the word stereotype?
Yeah, no one uses that.
But those are the two opposite conditions, and you should have a strong sense that this stereotomic is very solid and earth-like and carved into it, and the tectonic is stick-like, and you build and you make joints. So is number six clear? The compositional clarity between the horizontal planes and the vertical masses. Number seven, the organic integration of utilities. These new things called electric lights. These new things called air conditioning systems, electrical fixtures. All of these things that a lesser designer builder would just tack on after the fact. Frank Lloyd Wright says, no, let's make them a total work of art, a part of the architecture. A design work which embraces every utilitarian piece of equipment as a moment to celebrate, as a decorative element, not in the ornaments applied idea, but as not the ornamentation idea that we talked about in Art Nouveau, but the ornament. So what they call, remember the slide last time about ornament versus ornamentation? Ornamentation is applied later in that. Ornament grows in out from the very bones of the architecture itself and is good. The reason we don't use that distinction anymore between ornament and ornamentation is that we call it organic because it grows right out of the core of the architecture. So this one is a lot like that one, the organic integration of furnishing. Yes, it is indeed a Gesamtkunstwerk where the furniture and the cabinets are all designed by the architect, and whenever possible, they are attached and built into the building. When you sell your house, you got to leave that stuff behind as part of the sale price. That's what they say in real estate businesses. And you don't need a decorator. Fire your decorator. All you need is a good architect who celebrates every opportunity to bring artful quality and character and craft into the home design. So you don't need to hang a lot of frou-frou, frou-frou, and rip-rap, knick-knack, patty-rap. You just let the architecture express itself fully. Phew, okay, you got it? Those are the nine things. You got lots of little sketches. So, but wait. The in-class exercise doesn't say show and explain about the prairie school houses. It says the work of Frank Lloyd Wright. He didn't die in 1910, although some people wish he had. He lived for another 49 years. He was productive the entire time. Despite some people calling the next 20 years his lost years. Yes? What was number eight? The organic integration of furnishings, which is different from the organic integration of utilities. Understandable if you get those two confused. Again, these are Frank Lloyd Wright's categories. These are his nine principles. They're not exactly the same as my 20 top reasons to love a prairie school house period. So here's a whole lot of text about what he wrote about what it meant to do organic architecture. You don't have time to read all that. You got it, right? You showed examples. We don't need to read all the goddamn words. You saw the examples. Let's keep going. So as I said right at the beginning, he skips the country, flees town, escapes with the wife of his client, and he's invited to Germany, where there's a very strong fan club forming, and the Netherlands. You never hear about the Netherlands, but it's Germany. Because what they did is they said, hey, Frankie baby, you love your work. You're in Germany. Let's publish it. And so they published, they have new drawings made. They're beautiful. Look at that. They have, they publish it as a portfolio. Very expensive. Or a less expensive two-volume set. Or for the people, a very expensive book. I suspect you think that I've done it too. They would have to pry this class out of my cold, dead hands. I will not stop teaching you. This is Frank Lloyd Wright. This is a key core of your career and your professional success. So onwards. So the Dutch influence, and you're going to be seeing this in the next two lectures and into the Bauhaus, and you're going to see it in the world around you. Here are two, so they published all these drawings of Frank Lloyd Wright's Prairie School period. And this is what happened. It's so interesting. One group, under the guidance of the greatest Dutch architect of all time, no, not Jan Kalas, it was Hendrik Verlaatje, or Verlaat, I don't know how you say it in English. Verlaat, maybe Verlaat is the English pronunciation. So Verlaat loved Frank Lloyd Wright. He went to visit him in Chicago, and he came back and he told all his friends, you're going to love this guy. And so they get a hold of Frank Lloyd Wright's work, and they develop what is called the Amsterdam School. And Verlaat designs the entire district of Amsterdam South. If you haven't been, you will. Amsterdam is one of the greatest cities to visit in the world. And based on the kind of brickwork expression of materiality, manipulation of volumes, they developed this vocabulary out of Frank Lloyd Wright's influence into it's an entirely independent school called the Amsterdam School. How cool is that? Very nice. But then there's this other thing which is completely different called the Gestalt. We say Gestalt because we don't want to sound like we don't know Dutch, but the Dutch pronunciation is Gestalt. Yes, it sounds like the style, and yes, it does mean the style. The Dutch pronunciation, the appropriate pronunciation is Gestalt. But we will forgive you if you say the spiel because that's the commonly accepted mispronunciation of the movement in the United States. Very confusing. We negotiate. We do that without what we will. It's a tough negotiation. But talk about floating planes. Have you seen the Schroeder House in Utrecht? Have you seen it? If you haven't seen it, you will. In the next week or two, you're going to see the Gestalt movement architecture. You may not hear about the Amsterdam School ever again. Onward. So he didn't just do houses, he also did the Larkin Building, which revolutionized the approaches to office buildings. But we don't have time for that. Except to say, here's the interior. Look at that Larkin Building. The women in frilly white blouses, the secretarial pool, and the powerful white men up above in the executive suites. Furniture, yes, everything. But here's another important building. Yes, the Larkin Building, big office building, first, it's one of the pioneer uses of reinforced concrete slabs, but as a wall. Irving Gill in California is experimenting with tilt slab construction, but I believe this came before Irving Gill's experiments. This is steel reinforced cast concrete, not just as a structural frame, which is its usual purpose is structural frame, like this building, but this is the entire composition of walls as steel reinforced concrete. So you build the plywood formwork and you pour the concrete in layers as you go up. Now, about those screen windows. Remember the issue with Lodi House? He's trying to eliminate one of those six planes of the box as part of his mission to explode the box. Well, here he is. He's saying, okay, let's put the structural supports of these concrete columns outside. And then let's run an actual literal screen of glass on the inside of that. So it is, in this case, a continuous stream of glass. So this is, in a way, the ultimate achievement that he accomplishes after the earlier, after experimenting with it throughout all those paradigms. And again, you see these clear compositions. You have these very strong pylons at the four corners of this square space, and then you hang these planes from it. And notice the important detail of pulling back the plane so the plane doesn't meet at the corner. If the plane met at the corner, that would confuse the elemental distinction between each of these items. By pulling it back 8 inches from that corner, he's saying, the pylon is one thing. This balcony plane is a separate thing, right? That's a very important part of his compositional strategies, his compositional clarity. And so if you can almost start to get a sense of floating when you start to separate these things even more. I don't know if anyone else has noticed this. I don't know if this holds water. This is just me. When I walk into Trinity Church, I say, I've been here before. And when I walk into Unity Temple, I say, I've been here before because I've been to both places. And I'm like, oh, you know what? It's kind of like, get it? Is it true? Do you think it's right? I'm not sure. One is huge and old. This one's very small and intimate. But the thing, one of the clues that really gets me is the ceiling, the way the ceiling is treated. I think there might be something to it. This is a square plan. There are four balconies in, well, one of them is not a balcony, but three of the four elements of Trinity Church has a balcony in it. Three of these has a balcony on it. H.H. Richardson was a very important influence on Louis Sullivan. And Louis Sullivan was a very important influence on Frank Lloyd Wright. So it stands to reason that H.H. Richardson was also a very important influence on Frank Lloyd Wright. So one of the things we do in architecture is we draw connections. We draw connections forward, we draw connections back. I'm drawing this connection back to H.H. Richardson. The last connection I drew was forward to the Gestalt movement and the Amsterdam School. And from the Gestalt movement, we can go forward to the Bauhaus, from the Bauhaus to North American education, from North American education to your education. So there are connections that are available. The question is, what visual evidence do you find for making these connections? So this is me modeling appropriate behavior. No one has ever suggested to me that there's any connection between Church in Unity Temple. This is just me, a former student of the history of architecture, just observing the world, just making these connections wherever they present themselves. That's what you should be doing. Back to Japan. I don't know why Japan shows up in this class. It's like you can't get away from Japan. Here we are again back in Japan. Remember the last connection to Japan? It was the Ark of Noah was in part triggered by the sudden opening up of the Japanese cultures and arts to the world. And a lot of people seeing them and saying, oh my God, I have to rethink the way I paint and do graphic design and architecture. Well, Frank Lloyd Wright was one of these guys who was crazy about Japanese everything. As a matter of fact, he worked for a time across the street at the Museum of Fine Arts. He was their curator of Japanese prints. He went to Japan in 1905 and made connections there. But he was there purchasing prints. The reason Frank Lloyd Wright got to go to Japan in 1905, back when flying somewhere was actually a big deal. No, it was before the book. He used to take the boat. Right? When was Kitty Hawk? Red Boats. 1903? Well, anyway, Pan Am wasn't flying yet. So, yeah, he must have taken the ship. Go figure. So, it was a big deal to go to Japan. He was able to go to Japan because he was buying prints for the Museum of Fine Arts. And while he was there, he got connected up and he designed the Imperial Hotel. Tragically demolished and rebuilt. I don't know whether it's tragic that it was rebuilt, but it was quite a loss. But we don't have time. But he designed the plates for the Imperial Hotel. Is that German word? It's Amtmansberg. It's everywhere. So the next period of his production in the 20s is a series of houses where he is continuing the work of the Prairie School. You will see the ideas. You can still see the ideas, especially the compositional ideas of the Prairie School. But now, the thing that jumps out at us and we use to characterize this series of projects is the concrete block. He does these custom cast concrete blocks, and he designs a new custom block for every one of these houses. And so this is concrete block construction, where often he is eliminating one of the blocks and inserting a pane of glass. And sometimes these concrete blocks have big enough holes so that the glass can be inserted into the blocks themselves. So it's a very creative, inventive innovation of these glass inside of concrete blocks and glass substituting for concrete blocks that we see in this series of houses. Now, what does this idea of textile, why are they called textile blocks? What if we heard this idea of textiles as part of a wall? The German guy?
Yeah.
Yeah, that German guy.
Semper.
Semper. Yes. So Semper, one of his core things was that enclosures, the original primitive hut, again, he's using the primitive hut idea, the original architecture of enclosure is a woven mat. Is Semper coming to fruition through Frank Lloyd Wright's later work? So these houses are in California. Again, we still have the built-in furniture, the hearth as the most important massing at the heart of all of these intersecting major and minor orthogonal axes. And some of them are quite large. The Hollyhock House in Los Angeles is one of the biggest and most remarkable of these textile block houses. a reference to this motif inspired by the buds of the hollyhock blossom, which is a plant. What does that sound like? Talk about making connections. Biomimicry. And what was that lecture called last week? The last reason? Where we talked about that? The art of the boat. So where you start with an element of nature, you abstract the form of the hollyhock blossoms, and you create this decorative motif that, because you are casting repeatedly in concrete, you can make these elements, these modular elements that appear all over the house. Then he takes as a business model, because things are a little lean and he's quite the character, and he's getting a reputation for being difficult to work with. So as a business model, he says, I know, I will take this starting and I will cash in on it by establishing a school of interns who will come and work with me, be my drafts people. They will pay me, and they will bathe in the glow of my greatness, and they will become known as my disciples. And so that worked for all these white men. So he establishes it in his home in Wisconsin, and then he creates, and the home is like a laboratory for testing his ideas. It burns down when the maid goes crazy and kills his family. Watch the documentary film for all that stuff. But he rebuilds it, and then he builds, because the winters in Wisconsin are kind of cold and wet and snowy, he says, I'm going to build another one out in Arizona. So he does that. One of his disciples is Paolo Solari. Who is he? Who's Paolo Solari? You know who he is? He establishes this utopian community called Arco Santo, and he has been building, well, he just died, but for decades, he's been building a utopian urban architecture in the desert, not far from Taliesin West. If you're traveling through, stop by. Very interesting place. And so again, you see the principles that he's been developing throughout his career here, but we don't have time to go into it, because I want to touch on at least the next two things, right? Who has seen this before? One of the greatest pieces of architecture of the 20th century, some people would say ever. Do you see any of the principles at play in this image? So let's point and talk. So talk about floating planes. No one's ever floated a plane as floaty as this. Most of your colleagues, when they go to do a patio, they will build a structure, they'll put a deck on it, and then they'll put a railing on that. Well, if you know what you're doing structurally, by the way, Frank Lloyd Wright was a brilliant structural engineer, very innovative. He leaves out the structure underneath this thing because he knows that the railings can behave as beams. When is a railing more than just a railing? When it's a cantilever beam, right? It sagged a little, but my firm and I fixed it when I was working in the U.S. The masonry, the stereotomic vertical elements are all over here. So how do you float a plane on railings that are really deep? You just gotta float from something. Yeah, you can make it look like you're floating on some magnetic field, but just between us, there should, those forces need to go back to something, and then that something needs to take those forces down to the planet, where you can transfer those forces. So how do you do that? You have to know what you're doing. And in this case, you transfer those forces back to those vertical masonry stereoatomic elements. I'm going to use the word stereoatomic as many times as I possibly can. You can come from that. Look how screen-like this glass screen is. It's very, very light. So something is going on structurally to cantilever each of these beams out so that this very light steel frame doesn't have to carry the loads of those roof beams. So sometimes, if you know what you're doing structurally, you can achieve magical illusions of weightlessness and floating. Built-in furniture, cabinets, above and below, all of this stuff, shelving up here, even shelving built in to the upper portion of the wall that organically, see how I use that word organically? Organically are fused and unified and integrated with the mullions of the window there and are coordinated with the signature current school lighting fixture that is simultaneously an air handler for the house. There's no separate register. There's no separate thing for cooling. That's not really good. Well, maybe we can talk about the cantilevers here a little bit. So there's a waterfall that comes down through the living room and goes under the house. And all of these beams are cantilevered back to this massive stereoatomic masonry vertical element to carry the loads back into the cliff. And that's the secret of floating those patio, those decks out over the water. Next topic. So in 1934, during the deepest, darkest days of the Depression, there was an interrupted boom of growth across the United States where the automobile was becoming something that wealthy people can afford. That grid that Jefferson laid out in the 1784 Land Ordinance is starting to facilitate the sudden population of the middle of the United States, especially around Chicago. Remember the thing about Chicago as a machine for sucking all the commodity wealth of the middle of the United States across the grid and up through the railway system into Chicago where the meat is butchered and sent up in plastic wrap in refrigerated cars. The wealth, the lumber, the wheat, all of this money and commodity flow. So there's a lot of wealth being produced. The population is booming, but there's a depression going on. It's not going to last forever. Frank Lloyd Wright comes up with this idea that he calls Broadacre City. And it's characterized by this very extensive grid-like arrangement where there are minimum houses. When did we talk about minimum houses? Oh, you did that new class exercise of micro-units, and we talked about the first Siam meeting in 1927. Where they talked about the minimum dwelling unit. Well, Frank Lloyd Wright is paying attention to that. He notices the Siam movement. He's not joining their club, he's not going to their meetings, but he's reading what they're doing. And so he embraces the idea of the minimum dwelling house. And he establishes an urban plan that incorporates those ideas of dwelling houses laid out on the grid. Let's take a quick look at it. This is zoomed out. And this is zoomed in. The idea is that every household in the United States gets enough land to grow their own food. And so it's a self-sufficient agricultural plan of maximum sprawl. Right? We're about to change the planet in ways unprecedented before in human history through our suburban sprawl and our interstate highway system. Frank Lloyd Wright, as usual, is ahead of us, anticipating this is how you do it. This is a house, that's a house, that's a house, that's a house. These houses are very spread out. You need these minimum dwelling units. If you have to borrow a cup of sugar, it's a long walk. There's in the medium house zone, these houses are slightly larger, but in each case, the houses are as isolated as humanly possible, with enough land to grow your own food, organized on the grid, where you have schools, and if there's some really churches, it's more like places of worship, because he's imagining that everyone's becoming an atheist. Airports, bus terminals, produce centers, markets, cultural institutions. He's becoming a utopian planner around the same time as Corbusier was doing his Villarad News, the main city ideas that we looked at a few lectures ago. So it'd be very cool to compare Corbusier's utopian urban plans with Frank Lloyd Wright's utopian urban plans. I don't know, in Sam or something. And because he's the consummate designer, he designs new automobiles. He designs these automobiles with huge wheels. And while we're at it, why not? This is the hubris of architects. Let's design flying machines. And you have, he's also working on skyscraper ideas. He doesn't put them in the middle of cities. He places them as spaced out as possible across the grid of the United States as beacons marking the miles across the continent. And so here's an interesting image where you see his minor and major orthogonal axes crossing at chimneys. Now it's extending out and becoming an urban plan, or a suburban plan, where there are these axes that are extending from one house lot and one household to the other. So these architectures are starting to show up as nodes on this orthogonal axial plan that spreads across the United States. So it's not crazy to think of Jefferson's 1784 land ordinance growing up and going to architecture school and manifesting and expressing itself as these nodes of the crossings of these houses that are densifications of these grid fantasies of domination of the land, which is exactly what this is. The 1784 land ordinance is to dominate the landscape, to take control of it, to buy it and sell it easily, and now we want to occupy every acre of it, one family per acre, and we are going to control this continent from sea to shining sea, one family, 1 acre. Ownership is the future of the United States, no rental. Not a very good plan. But you see the expression of the houses, very familiar. Prairie school houses, still with us. Now, how do you build all these houses? Prairie school houses are for wealthy clients. They're very expensive. Everyone in the United States is going to hire Frank Lloyd Wright and build one of these fancy houses. I think we need a mass production solution to this problem of housing in the United States. Let's use the textile block technology and let's establish some clever things that, yes, Frank Lloyd Wright invented these things and we take them for granted today. Picture windows, where there's a fixed piece of glass and windows that open on either side, Frank Lloyd Wright. Slab on grade foundations of every house in California and the Southwest, Frank Lloyd Wright. Garages attached to the building, Frank Lloyd Wright. Radiant floor heating in concrete slab, Frank Lloyd Wright. Get rid of the basement, get rid of the attic, Frank Lloyd Wright. And so He was a big fan of the genius of indigenous populations that occupied the Americas prior to the European arrival and the annihilation of 95% of the population in the first 100 years. So he was rightfully uncomfortable using the word American. And he wanted to come up with something as an alternative to the term American, which is kind of a problem. As soon as you figure out, as soon as you meet someone who's from Brazil, and they say, this is America, why do you call yourself American? I'm American too. Brazil is America, right? America stretches from Tierra del Fuego to the Arctic Circle. Those are the Americas. Who do you get off in the United States calling yourself Americans? You're not American, and, well, we don't have a name. Well, Frank Lloyd Wright said, well, I don't know, United Statesians, it's kind of awkward. Let's, how about, you just stick along here, how about U.S.onians? How do you like that? How about U.S.onians? Or, it's a little awkward, let's call it Usonian. So these are his Usonian houses. Crazy, right? So they are masonry structures that are built to be modular, mass-produced, but custom. And how do you mass-produce and customize it? You mass-produce the blocks that interlock, that you can put utilities in, that you can assemble on site with simple labor, and you set it up on the 4x8 grid. I think it's a 4x8 grid. No, it's a 2x4 grid. What could be more American than foot base for Usonian? A grid based on a 1x2 proportion grid. It's like sheets of plywood. Everyone else wishes they had. So it's a grid strategy to producing these houses. The first one was in 1938, it was Jacob's house. But whenever you hear 1938 Jacob's house, you should think, ah, the first of the Usonian houses, right? So the Usonian house type was a plan to house a huge population in homes that they owned on 1 acre of land each, which would give us each self-sufficiency in agriculture. Urban agriculture, anyone? He was doing it in 1938. So a mixture of brick and block. You'll notice that each brick course is how many inches? Anyway, three, I don't see any cinder block walls here, but three courses of brick is equal to one course of concrete block. That's the mathematical geometrical rhythm of the Usonian system. Then there's the Guggenheim Museum. Everyone likes the Guggenheim Museum. It's not too loud. People say that he was awarded his commission at a time when he's saying, listen, forget about cities. We need to spread out across the continent. I hate cities. Cities are oppressive and demeaning. I want to stretch out across the landscape. still, the sculptural experience of the space itself, and the sculptures that people hang or put inside the space over the decades has been a long history of quite remarkable interaction between the architecture and a whole series of artists. But somehow
we got a few more.
So there's at least one photo of a sculpture and people in the Rubens. And then his final, some would say, quirkiest design built after he's dead is the Marin County Courthouse, or Marin County Civic Center. It has a courthouse in it. It's called the Civic Center. And it's the space age, like, space invader thing that is set into the hills of San Rafael, Marin County, California, just north of San Francisco. And he gets an idea for these arches and just applies it. And you have this very interesting space inside these corridors, incorporating the automobile into the architecture. The cars drive in, they park. And these are basically offices, municipal offices for Marin County. So, any questions?